In the early 1960s, the Bristol 188 blazed through the tumultuous Cold War skies, a product of the intense race for technological dominance between East and West. The most expensive British research aircraft project at the time of its creation, this state-of-the-art steel marvel was built to push the boundaries of supersonic flight and conquer speeds beyond Mach 2. Nicknamed the Flaming Pencil, its needle-like fuselage and swept-back wings epitomized the peak aerodynamics of the era, a futuristic testament to British innovation and engineering prowess. However, creating an aircraft capable of traveling at such blistering speeds would pose serious challenges that would put Bristol's design team to the test. Extremely high velocities meant extremely high temperatures, meaning that the structure and materials used would require careful consideration. The project was driven by the determined desire of the designers to overcome these obstacles and reach their goals. While the Bristol 188's career was short-lived, never seeing operational use, the critical insights into aerodynamic heating and material resilience yielded from the program influenced future breakthroughs in aviation, most notably paving the way for the iconic Concorde supersonic passenger jet, which would revolutionize commercial air travel in ways never previously thought possible. The origins of the Bristol 188 reach back to 1952. By that time, advancements in jet propulsion had made aircraft capable of Mach 1 speeds a near certainty, but in February of that year, the Ministry of Supply set its sights even higher with the introduction of Experimental Requirement ER-134T. This requirement called for an aircraft capable of maintaining twice the speed of sound in level flight for an extended period to study the effects of kinetic heating at high Mach numbers. After a number of manufacturers submitted designs, Bristol's Type 188 emerged the victor, leading to a contract in February 1953 for two prototypes powered by Rolls-Royce Avon RA-24 turbojets along with a non-flying structural test airframe. Subsequent advancements in speed capabilities led to an updated specification, ER-134D, for both 188 prototypes, increasing the target maximum speed to Mach 2.5. This necessitated the search for new engines, as the Avon engine's performance would diminish at speeds above Mach 2.1 at higher altitudes. Bristol also planned to build three additional 188S to test Armstrong Siddeley's P-176 turbojet engine, intended for the Avro 730, a highly advanced strategic platform designed to reach three times the speed of sound. By 1955, the order for the 188 included five airframes. However, Defense Minister Duncan Sandy's white paper in 1957 led to significant cutbacks, including the cancellation of the Avro 730 project, resulting in only the first two prototypes being built. These changes, along with the Avon engine's limitations, necessitated a new power plant capable of sustained supersonic speeds. In 1957, Bristol chose to power the 188 with two de Havilland PS 50 Guyron Jr. engines, each providing 10,000 pounds of thrust dry and 14,000 pounds with afterburner. These powerful engines enabled the Type 188 structure to handle speeds of Mach 1.2, around 761 miles per hour, at sea level, and exceed Mach 2.5 at altitudes of 35,000 feet and above. However, in order to integrate the PS-50s, a redesign of the wing-mounted nacelles was required. At over 16 feet long, these nacelles dwarfed the 188's relatively small wings, which had a span of 35 feet 1 inch and a total area of just over 396 square feet. Challenges like these, along with the aircraft's complex design, repeatedly delayed its first flight. At first glance, the Bristol 188 appeared to be a straight-wing aircraft, but in reality, the leading edge was swept to 38 degrees near the fuselage and increased to 64 degrees beyond the nacelles. This variable sweep design was chosen to optimize aerodynamic performance at high speeds, with the initial sweep providing stability and control at lower speeds, while the increased sweep beyond the nacelles reduced drag and improved performance at supersonic speeds. The inner wing featured triangular leading edge strakes at each end, which helped to manage airflow over the wings, reducing turbulence and enhancing stability during high-speed flight. The plane trailing edge flaps were included to improve lift during takeoff and landing, crucial for an aircraft designed to operate over a wide range of speeds. The all-moving wingtips, formed by the ailerons on the trailing edge past the engines, provided improved roll control. At supersonic speeds, traditional control surfaces often become less effective, so having all-moving surfaces ensured the Bristol 188 maintained maneuverability even at its maximum speeds. The wing box was created using front and rear spars, forming a robust structure capable of withstanding the stresses of high-speed flight. The main undercarriage retracted into the inner section of the main plane, with the wheels lodging in the empennage, minimizing drag and maintaining a sleek aerodynamic profile. The fuselage was designed with an oval cross-section and featured a conventional stressed skin structure. This design provided the necessary strength and rigidity to withstand the high aerodynamic forces experienced during supersonic flight. Inside the fuselage, 5 fuel tanks were housed, ensuring sufficient fuel capacity for extended high-speed operations. The nose of the aircraft contained a single-place pressurized cockpit, essential for pilot safety and comfort at high altitudes and speeds. This cockpit was equipped with the necessary test equipment to collect data on the aircraft's performance and the effects of kinetic heating. On each side of the rear fuselage, the 188 was fitted with cascade-type air brakes for decelerating the aircraft from high speeds and enhancing control during descent and landing. Positioned below the T-tail, they provided effective aerodynamic braking without disrupting the aircraft's stability. The T-tail itself featured an all-moving slab-type horizontal stabilizer, allowing for more precise control and stability at supersonic speeds. Traditional stabilizers often become less effective at high speeds, so an all-moving design ensured that the 188 could maintain its desired flight attitude and respond effectively to pilot inputs. The vertical fin was constructed using a multi-spar structure, providing the necessary strength to withstand the aerodynamic forces encountered during flight. The leading edge of the fin incorporated a 65-degree sweep, optimizing the aircraft's aerodynamic performance and stability at high speeds. This swept design reduced drag and improved the overall aerodynamic efficiency of the aircraft. One of the primary challenges in the 188's development was selecting an airframe material that could endure the intense heat generated during sustained flight at Mach 2. The available aluminum alloys of the time were inadequate for this purpose, as they could not withstand the high temperatures without significant degradation. The advanced materials that would eventually be used in the Concorde supersonic passenger jet were still under investigation and not yet viable for use. Given these constraints, stainless steel emerged as the only feasible alternative. Stainless steel could endure extreme thermal stresses and maintain its structural integrity under the high temperatures encountered at such high speeds. This choice of material allowed the 188 to operate safely and effectively during its high-speed test flights, providing crucial data on the effects of kinetic heating and advancing the understanding of materials science in the aerospace industry. A Firth-Vickers alloy was eventually chosen, but developing suitable fabrication processes took 2 years. These processes needed to meet precise tolerances for surface flatness, finish, and thickness. Traditional riveting was considered, but new welding and joining techniques were ultimately introduced, resulting in one of the smoothest finishes ever seen on an aircraft. Extensive engine and airframe instrumentation was installed to relay continuous telemetry readouts to ground receivers. This included strain gauges, several hundred transducers, and both paper and magnetic tape recorders. A powerful refrigeration system was fitted to protect the devices and the pilot from the high temperatures generated by friction at these speeds. During the design period, models of the 188 were tested for aerodynamic flutter behavior using rockets fired from the Royal Aircraft Establishment's Aberporth facility in Wales. In May 1960, the static test airframe was delivered to their facility at Farnborough in Hampshire for structural testing before being transported to its Bedford facility about a year later. The first airworthy Bristol 188, known as XF-923, was completed on April 26, 1961, but engine problems during bench testing and ground running necessitated modifications to the air intakes. Initial ground runs began on October 23rd, followed by taxi trials in late January 1962, before eventually taking to the skies for the first time on April 14, 1962, with Bristol's chief test pilot Godfrey Audi at the controls. Taking off from Filton, Gloucestershire, he landed 21 minutes later at the Aeroplane and Armament Experimental Establishment in Boscombe Down, Wiltshire, to begin low-speed handling trials at medium altitudes. Despite numerous delays in the test flight schedule, XF-923 was publicly unveiled at the Society of British Aircraft Constructors show in Farnborough in early September 1962, with the British press quickly nicknaming the aircraft the Flaming Pencil. However, on September 8th, Audi had to cut short his display when fumes filled the cockpit, and his instruments indicated unusually high oil consumption. The aircraft had only been cleared to fly the previous week after engine removal and rectification work. On November 15th, the Bristol 188 returned to Filton for ground resonance tests. Up until this point, all test flights had been conducted from Boscombe Down. However, on November 30th, a final sortie took place from Filton. During this 39-minute flight, Audi pushed XF-923 to Mach 0.86, the fastest it ever flew. This was the airframe's final and longest flight. Due to bad weather, frequent technical problems including regular engine flameouts and other challenges, XF-923 was grounded after just 19 flights. After completing the resonance tests, the engines were removed, and the airframe was placed in storage, where it was continually cannibalized to keep XF-926 operational. Despite its brief career, the prototype's flying characteristics were considered very good, and its systems operated satisfactorily. However, ongoing issues with the Gyron Jr. engine during testing meant that achieving Mach 2 flight was not expected until spring 1964. With continued setbacks, the program's value came under scrutiny in the autumn of 1962, but was allowed to continue. The second prototype, XF-926, conducted its preliminary ground runs in mid-March of the following year. It made its first flight on April 23, 1963, with a duration of 30 minutes, piloted once again by Audi. Initially, due to delays, XF-926 flew using the lower-speed Gyron Jr. turbojets from XF-923. Over the next 4 weeks, the aircraft completed 14 additional flights, gradually increasing its Mach number. By May 23rd, it achieved a speed of 1.64 Mach, equivalent to 1,096 miles per hour, at an altitude of 40,000 feet. In spite of its potential, the Bristol 188 faced significant setbacks due to a faulty reheat nozzle that curbed progress. The PS-50 turbojets, which powered the aircraft, were notoriously unreliable, largely due to insufficient development. These engines were prone to surging under specific conditions, causing the aircraft to oscillate unpredictably in pitch and yaw. Additionally, issues with vibrations plagued the flight experience. However, the core issue lay in the fact that the 188 was the sole aircraft utilizing this particular version of the Gyron Jr. engine. Consequently, the manufacturer lacked the necessary time to address and resolve these critical weaknesses. By the end of July 1963, XF-926 had completed an additional 22 flights, yet it had become evident that the aircraft lacked the fuel capacity for prolonged supersonic travel. Notably, Flight 16 on June 12th endured for just 48 minutes, marking it the longest flight undertaken by either of the 188 models. Over the following 2 months, the aircraft achieved supersonic speeds on 12 occasions, peaking at Mach 1.83 during its final flight on July 31st. Subsequently, XF-926 was grounded throughout August and September for a re-engining process. It re-emerged on October 4th equipped with Mach 2 capable Gyron Jr. engines, ready to push the boundaries once more. Despite the upgrades, progress remained slow. By mid-December, only 12 additional flights had been completed, largely due to issues with the intake guide vanes and frequent surging of the power plants. Nevertheless, amidst these challenges, the team successfully resolved the earlier problems with the afterburners. On November 25th, during Flight 47, XF-926 soared to its highest speed yet, reaching Mach 1.88, equivalent to 1,242 miles per hour, at 36,000 feet. Just 2 days prior, it had nearly touched Mach 1.9 when an engine surge occurred. Although the Bristol 188 demonstrated impressively low drag, the data revealed it could sustain Mach 2 speeds for only a fleeting 1 minute and 30 seconds, with a theoretical maximum capability of Mach 2.2. As the program neared its end, inclement weather postponed the final three sorties until January 1964. On January 11th, piloted by Bristol test pilot Willie Williamson, the XF-926 performed its 51st and final sortie, bringing the 188 project to its conclusion. It had been Britain's most expensive research aircraft to date, costing £20 million at the time, more than £346 million in today's money, and also marked the last aircraft constructed by the Bristol Aeroplane Company, which, at the behest of the British government, merged with English Electric Aviation, Vickers Armstrongs, and Hunting Aircraft to form the British Aircraft Corporation. While the Bristol 188 never transitioned into an operational aircraft, the extensive data it collected on kinetic heating and material performance at high speeds significantly influenced the development of the Concorde. While a proposal for a further 60-flight 188 program to support the project was rejected, the lessons learned about thermal stresses and material behavior under extreme conditions helped in selecting materials like the aluminum alloy used in Concorde's airframe. Beyond its impact on Concorde, research conducted with the 188 contributed broadly to the field of materials science, aiding in the development of heat-resistant materials for various high-speed military and civilian aircraft. Its pioneering work in testing methodologies and integration of advanced telemetry and instrumentation systems set new standards for experimental aircraft programs, enhancing the safety and performance of subsequent aerospace designs. While the first Bristol 188, XF-923, was scrapped, the second, XF-926, can be seen today at RAF Museum Cosford in Shropshire. Its legacy standing is a testament to the value of experimental testing in pushing the boundaries of technology and knowledge in aerospace engineering.